Good afternoon, and perhaps even good evening to those of you that are joining us from out of state, from out of country. We are just truly, truly grateful that you have decided to come back to another night. Just welcome one and all, welcome all of you to another study of the Book of Daniel and Revelation. My name is Will Abbey. I'll be your host for the rest of this series. And again, I just want to pause to recognize that today would not be the day it is if you are not joining us on Facebook, if you are not joining us on YouTube. And so we are deeply, deeply grateful that you've decided to come and join us yet again. For those of you that had technical issues joining us last night, we are sorry, and we've got it right, hopefully, and that you found the link and that you've been able to join us on the platform. But look, don't worry if you struggled to find us yesterday. If you have a pen or paper, I just want to remind you where you can find yesterday's presentation. It is www.thyhykd.com. So www.thyhykd.com. And you can find what you missed yesterday. But look, we have a powerful, powerful study set up for you today. As always, and when we are opening God's word, it is so important that we invite his presence into our midst. So I will start with a short word of prayer, and then we will set the stage for another powerful Bible study through the word, through the use of music. And then shortly after that, you will hear our presenter for the day, Dr. O'Connor. So let us pray. Eyes closed, thoughts lifted heavenwards. If I can encourage you just to make sure that your mics are on mute and so that the presence of the Holy Spirit can fill this platform and can fill your homes. Father, we are so grateful that you have once again spared our lives and that you have created within us a desire to come and seek your word. We're so grateful that you have given us the Bible, that you have given us your word, and we pray, Lord, that you will give us the wisdom and the patience to clearly seek your word. We cannot understand your word if you're not with us. And so we ask, Lord, that you give us that wisdom that enables us, that will enable us to understand your word. We thank you, and we ask, Lord, that you will continue to be with us throughout the remainder of this series. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. You know, where would we be without music? Where would we be without music? So sit back, relax, and just look heavenwards as we usher in the start of today's presentation through the use of music.
Holy words
Amen, amen, amen. Our presenter for these studies is no stranger to the prophetic word. He has spent a considerable amount of his lifetime studying end-time prophecy. He has spoken on the subject in many countries across the world, in Europe, in Africa, in the United States of America, and also in the Caribbean. He is currently writing his first book on the subject entitled, Is God Still? Ladies and gentlemen, please help me to welcome Dr. Shine O'Connor. Dr. Shine O'Connor, over to you.
Thank you, Will. Thank you so much. Good morning, everybody. Those of you who are in morning and those of you who are in the afternoon section, wherever you are joining us, we are delighted to have you this morning. We hope and trust that as we spend the time studying together here, you will be tremendously blessed from it. By the way, those of you who have been part of my campaigns in the past, you will know that I really love that song, Ancient Words. You really know that. I really love Ancient Words. It's a beautiful song, and I give God thanks and praise for the fact that we can spend some time singing that song. I want you to know the song, right? I want you to get to know the song. It's a tremendous song that will bless your heart once you get to know it. And we're going to be using it every day, so you're going to get very much familiar with the song. Ancient Words is a very, very special song for me, and so I give God thanks that you are able to know the song. I want you to be able to sing it when you're traveling to work, in the traffic, or on your shopping, wherever you are, or even when you're cooking, just sing that song. It brings so much joy to my heart, and I'm sure it will do for you as well. All right, so let me also just take the time out to thank all of you who have decided to join us. There are three different platforms that we are sharing this morning. So those of you joining us on Zoom, we welcome you and are delighted to have you. And those of you joining live on Facebook and on YouTube. So we have three different electronic platforms that we are sharing on. So whichever them you are joining us from, we're delighted to have you. And we hope that everything goes well. Last night, as you heard, we had a little challenge in terms of some of the platform, but we have worked out all the crinkses, and so we're now ready to roll. Thank you so much. Delighted to have everybody. Some people worship all the way from South Florida, some people in the Cayman Islands, some people in Brazil, some people in Trinidad. Wherever you are worshiping or studying with us, we are delighted to have you today. So I want to just give you a little heads up in what we're working on today. Today, we're going to unpack the most, if you ask me, the single most specific, and in my mind, most fundamental piece of prophecy in the entire Bible. And if you ask me why, because this is the one piece of prophecy that gives us a timetable for the end. And so you will come across a number of pieces of prophecies that deal with things like the mark of the beast and wars and rumors of wars and all the other stuff. This one is a little different. What this one does is kind of give you a checklist so you can check off where you are and know exactly how close we are to the second coming of Christ. So if you go around and telling people, oh, you know, the Lord soon come and the world soon, and yes, we know that. But what's your proof? Today, we are going to give you that proof. It is buried deep in the prophetic word of Daniel. You will be excited when we excavate it. Powerful stuff. Powerful stuff. I hope we can get that. We can get everything in within the 1 hour that we have scheduled with you. If not, then we will have to come back and pick up the pieces. But we're not going to rush it. We're going to take our time because it is very important that you're able to really get the substance of this very important prophecy. The most important piece of prophecy in the entire Bible, I told you from last night, is in chapter 2 of Daniel. And that's where we're going to be heading. So I'm going to put up, by the way, one more piece of information I'd like to share with you. Because we are working in the Bible verse by verse, right? It is not going to be a situation where I put all the verses on screen. I'm going to put all the verses on the screen today, right? But I'm going to give you a notice. What I want you to do is to have your own Bibles, and I want you to be able to open them, and I want you to be able to read them for yourself, right? So even though sometimes some of the texts may be on the screen, I really want to discourage that. I want you to be able to have your own Bibles. And if you are watching via a phone or a laptop or whatever, have a separate device for your Bible, or have a separate, you know, paper Bible, right? Have a separate paper Bible if you so wish, or a separate device in which you have your Bible, so you're not confused as you shift from one to the other. So I would strongly encourage you have a paper-based Bible if you can, or you have a separate device that you can turn to the scripture when we're working as we go forward, all right? So be aware of that. But for today, for this particular session, I'm going to put the words on the screen because there are some issues, some points I want to highlight as we put it on the screen for you. Very, very important. So this is the time you want to just check around your friends if you want to invite anybody, particularly if you have people who you'd love to hear this particular subject about the timetable for the second coming of Christ. This is the prophecy. This is the time. That's what we're going to unpack. So welcome to the series, all right? So let me see if I can put share my screen with you. And here we go. Good. And good. So let's see. There we go with my screen. I'm going to put all this up here. Right. Good. So we are diving back in the books of Daniel and Revelation. And last night we gave you this piece of information. For those of you who may want to contact if there are questions you want to ask, we're going to probably have some time after the presentation to get some questions from you if you have questions to ask. But if you want to be able to communicate with me, if you look over the whole study and you realize maybe my life is not too right, I want to reconnect with the Lord and recommit my life to Him, and you'd like to do so, you want to communicate that to me, that's fine. So you can do that at 650-450-1380. That's on your screen, 650-450-1380. You can send me a text or give me a call, or you can email me, right? And it is thykdcome, right? Thy kingdom come. KD is for kingdom, right? That's our topic of our series. So the email address is thykdcome@gmail.com, right? thykdcome@gmail.com. So you can send me an email if, you know, as we study something or if there's something that you'd like to query or something you'd like to follow up on, wherever in the world you are watching this series, please go ahead, send me that email and be able to communicate that with you, all right? Okay, so we're diving into today's subject. We're in chapter 2 of the book of Daniel. So if you're following me, you want to get your Bibles out. And I normally use the New King James Version. That's the version that I fall in love with. So you may want to, if you have that version, that's the one I'll be using. But if you have the regular King James Version, then that's fine. Or the New International, whatever version you have, that's fine. But the one I'm using is going to be the New King James Version. And when I look at the subject matter for today, I have to entitle it The Secret, The Secret. So why don't you bow your heads with me then and let us ask God's direction. Father, thank you so much for one more opportunity to take some time out and dig into your word, to excavate it. Because we know that deep within it, it are gold nuggets, valuable nuggets for our soul salvation. So give us wisdom now, Holy Spirit. Open up our minds and open up our understanding as we dig into your words again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. So we talk about secrets, right? One of the biggest secrets that we can ever have on planet Earth. Big question people always ask. When is God coming back? When will the world end? The disciples asked Jesus that question, right? When are you coming back? And so that's one of the unanswered question. When will the Lord return? When will the world come to an end? And that's a big secret. And that's what we're going to unpack today, right? So one of the first thing we know, the Bible makes it very clear. There's no debate on this. Nobody knows the exact date nor hour when the Son of Man shall return. So you will not get a date or an hour because nobody knows that. What you will get is information God has given to us that takes us as closely as possible to that time, right? So hang on for your seatbelts and let's see if we can jump right in. Well, first of all, if we're talking about finding the secret, the biggest secret known to mankind is when is the Lord coming back? Here's what Amos 3 verse 7 says, very popular text. Amos says, surely the Lord will do nothing. All right, let's get that back, right? Surely the Lord will do nothing unless he reveals his secret to his servants, the prophets. Notice that. Surely the Lord will, God does nothing unless he reveal his secret to his servants, the prophets. So if we are pursuing this secret of the second coming of Christ, then the place we must look, right, or the sources that we must excavate is the words of the prophets, right? But who are the prophets? Who are his servants, the prophets? There are so many of them. Well, there's one that stands out, and this one, the Lord, we talked about that last night, that Jesus credentialized him, authorized him, right? Jesus recommended him when Christ was here in Matthew 24, verse 15. Jesus says, therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel, the prophet. You know, even if Jesus had said spoken of by Daniel and leave it there, it would be good enough. But he added Daniel, the prophet. And that is what we're looking for. Because if Jesus identified Daniel as a prophet or the prophet, then I know Daniel must have the secrets based on what Amos just told us, right? So that's why we are going in pursuit of Daniel. Anything Daniel says, right? Anything Daniel prophesies, we can believe it. Why? Because Jesus Christ authenticated him. And that's the assurance we have going into the study. We know Daniel is not a false prophet. And that's what I'm saying. Everybody nowadays, in these last days, the source of the Bible that we should be really studying is the Daniel the prophet and John in Revelation, because that's where the information is that is relevant for our time. Okay, so let's dive into chapter 2 then of Daniel, right? Daniel chapter 2. Last night we were in chapter 1. If you were here last night, you'd have studied how Daniel found himself in Babylon. Chapter 2 now that we're starting is taking place in Babylon. Daniel is not from Babylon. Daniel is a Jew. Daniel was among the hundreds and thousands of Jews that were captured as prisoners when in 605 BC, Nebuchadnezzar marched his army all the way from Babylon in the vicinity of where Iraq is and Kuwait, that area, marched themselves all the way over to Babylon, attacked the kingdom of Judah and the city of Jerusalem, plundered it, and took a number of Israel Jews back down to Babylon, thousands of them back down to Babylon, and that's where they were as prisoners down here. Right, and we told you last evening also that it is three times that Babylon attacked Judah, and three times he carried on three sets of people and then plundered the entire city, destroyed Jerusalem completely, destroyed the temple completely, and Jerusalem was in such a ruin, complete ruin, right? And so now the Jews were down in Babylon serving King Nebuchadnezzar. And that's where we find Daniel. Last evening also we studied that when he arrived in Babylon with the four, with three friends, right? They were given a three-year scholarship in the Babylonian University. They studied politics, they studied royal courtship, everything. They studied for entire 3 years. And after the end of 3 years, King Nebuchadnezzar interviewed them. We studied that last night, and found that they were 10 times brighter and better than any other wise man in the city or in the kingdom of Babylon. Now, consider that. And we said last night, we gave you a hint last night, that because they have now risen to the creme de la creme of academia, they have now risen to the creme de la creme of knowledge and wise men in the entire city, entire kingdom. As a result of that, that actually put them into trouble. And that's what we're going to unpack today. All right, so let's jump into chapter 2. If you're just joining us, we're in Daniel chapter 2, verse 1. So here's where the Bible says. Daniel chapter 2 and verse 1 says, now in the second year of Nebuchadnezzar's reign. One of the first thing I want you to note as you are studying, so this is not a sermon we're preaching, we're taking our time and we're studying, and I want you to be able to understand the Bible when you study it, right? Now, and to understand the Bible when you study it, you have to take some time, you have to take your time, right, and notice some of the things that are in the literature. So for example, you will notice that they are date stamping the chapter, right? So chapter 2 open with a date stamp. Here's it, in the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar. So that gives us an idea of what time we're talking about, right? Nebuchadnezzar started reigning in 605 BC. So you're looking at somewhere about the 603, somewhere off there, right? So that's a date stamp. So in the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, he had dreams. Nebuchadnezzar had dreams, and his spirit was so troubled that his sleep left him. Well, hey, that's something normal, right? Some of us wake up in the morning and we have dreams, and boy, we can't remember what we dreamt. We just know that we dreamt last night, but we can't remember what we dreamt, right? So that's what happened to my friend Nebi. I'm going to call him Nebi, all right? Nebio. Let's call him Nebio. Long name, Nebuchadnezzar. I'm going to call him Nebio, right? So that's what happened to my friend Nebio. He had a dream. He dreamt last night, woke up in the morning, knew that he dreamt something, knew that it was significant, unusual, you know, but he can't remember what he dreamt. The Bible says his sleep left him. And the fact that the Bible says his sleep left him, notice the text, the sleep left him is a way of saying he jumped out of his sleep. He woke up out of his sleep. Maybe like a, you know, when you have a nightmare and he jumped out of his sleep, right? Then verse 2 says, then the king gave the command to call the magicians, the astrologers, the sorcerers, and the Chaldeans to tell the king his dreams. So they came and stood before him. So hang on, let's just break this down a little bit, right? So I am assuming that in the morning when Nebu woke up, right, he's troubled by the fact that he cannot remember what he dreamt last night, but he knows it's a significant dream. So here's what verse 2 says. So what he did was decided to call in the situation room, yeah? So he sent out a telegram or a text or whatever they use those days to communicate, servants. And he decided to call a group of people who he felt are expert in these matters. In what matters? These are the experts in the guy. These are the guys who can tell you things before they happen, right? They profess themselves to be expert in the future, an expert into what's going to happen, right? They can tell you what about dream and vision and what's going to happen in your life. So here, the first set that he called were the magicians. So these are the guys who, you know, magicians. Everybody seems to know who magicians are. They work magic, right? They can work magic. So they need to be here and use their magic to tell the king what he had just dreamt, right? All right. Hopefully their magic is good enough. So of course they got dressed and they put on their best, and because they're going to the king, and they turn up. And then the king also sent for the astrologers. Now, if the magician can help, well, at least the astrologers, these are the guys who specializes in the future, mm-hmm. because they can read your star and tell you whether you're going to fall in love, whether you're going to travel, whether you're going to be healthy, whether you're going to, you know, your future under the stars, right? So they tell you whether you're a Pisces or a Gemini or, you know, Capricorn or whatever. These are the guys. And so they profess that they are specialists. Of course, so they must be in a position to can tell the king what he dreamt last night. So of course they came in their chariots, mm-hmm. and then the king also sent for another set. These are the sorcerers. I just love this. These guys, the sorcerers, now they specialize into something completely different. These are the guys who now communicate with the dead. Mm-hmm. So they can bring up your dead grandma and let your grandma tell you what's going to happen in the future, right? All right. And that's how they profess themselves. That's how they advertise themselves. They can talk to the spirits in the spirit world and tell you what's going to happen. And by the way, do you know how many people believe in this foolishness? People tell you that they can talk to your dead people and your dead people tell you what's going to happen in the future. If that were so, boy, many people would have won the lottery, right? Just think about it, right? So anyway, these sorcerers, they dressed up and they come. And then the last set that the king asked for to join him in the meeting is the Chaldeans. Now, most of you may not know who the Chaldeans are. So the Chaldeans, they are the academic set. They are the academicians. They are the intellectuals, right? They are the scholarly type. These are the university professors, the lecturers, right? Right. So get the idea. These are the knowledgeable people, the well-trained, well-educated people, right? And you're going to notice, you're going to see this term Chaldeans, because they're going to be the spokesperson for the group, because they are the more formally trained, well, highly educated group of people. So these are the people the kings call for. So if you walk in the king's room, situation room, man, you'll see the magicians there. And look, there's an S behind their name, their category, right? So it's more than one. A group of magicians over here, a group of astrologers over here, a group of sorcerers over here, and a group of the Chaldeans over here, the educated one. They met in the situation room. Why? Because the king has a problem. Have you noticed that there's a group that is missing? Anybody want to tell me which group is missing here? Just, you can just release your microphone and talk back to me. Anybody? Which group?
Prophets. Prophets.
Okay, the prophets. Good. The prophets. Exactly. That is a good, very good classification. The prophets are missing, and in that group of the prophets would be Daniel. Yep. Now think about it. If you are there in your Bible, quickly turn, I'm not going to change my screen, right? But quickly turn your Bible over to chapter 1 of Daniel. And if you are there, I'm going to give you permission just to turn your Bible over to chapter 1 of Daniel. Daniel chapter 1. And I want you to look at verse 20. It's not going to be on your screen. Just take your Bible and look at Daniel chapter 1 and verse 20. And Daniel chapter 1, verse 20 tells you that Daniel should have been in this meeting. Look at chapter 1, verse 20. Here's what it says. Hope you're there. I can't see you, so I'm hoping by faith that you're there, because my screen is on, so I can't see you. But here's what Daniel 1, 20 says. And in all matters of wisdom and understanding, about which the king examined them. The them there is Daniel and the three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. he found, the king found them 10 times better than all the magicians and the astrologers who were in all his realm. So hang on, people. If these four boys are 10 times better than the magicians and the astrologers and the Chaldeans, why aren't they in this meeting? That's a good question. Keep that in the back of your mind, right? Because they're the ones, they're the first one that should have been there. God is too wise. See, God brought these guys together. God brought these devil workers together, right? The devil science, the demonic scientists. God brought them together, right? To prove their error, to prove their failure. God ain't going mixing up truth with error. I hope I'm coming across to you right here. God ain't going mixing up no truth with error. So even though Daniel and the three Hebrew boys really should have been in this group because they are the best of the best, and the king knew that because he interviewed them in chapter 1 and knew that, really, they are not in this meeting, right? God keep them separate. And so these guys who advertise themselves to be astrologers. By the way, I hope those of you who ever use astrologers and pay magicians and sorcerers and voodoo men and obeah men, I hope you guys, you're listening here because you're going to realize that this is all one bag of complete delusion. Okay, delusion. So they came forward and they sat before the king. Daniel and the guys are missing. And the Bible says they stood before the king. Okay, let's roll the tape and see what happened in verse 3. So in verse 3, as they sat down and they took their seat, they perhaps get a cup of coffee or whatever juice they get, and you know, royal treatment. Now the king says to them now, king said to them, guys, I have had a dream and my spirit is anxious to know the dream. Okay. Okay, king, good. Keep on. Then the Chaldeans spoke up. See, the Chaldeans, I tell you, they're the spokesman, right? So for the group, right? They spoke up to the king in Aramaic. And one of the reasons why Daniel said they spoke up in Aramaic, Aramaic is not the common language or the language of the common man, right? Aramaic is the language that the educated people use, right? If you're from Jamaica, English is the language that the educated people use, and Patois is the language that the uneducated tend to use, right? and I think in some other areas you have your Creole and French, that kind of stuff. So I don't know what they do in Spanish and the other languages, but you get the picture. So they spoke in proper language to the king because they are the educated one. So they said, O king, live forever. By the way, that's how you always address the king, right? You don't do that, you're dead. O king, live forever. Tell your servants the dream and we will give you the interpretation. Supply us with the dream, right? And we will give you the interpretation. That's the strategy. By the way, that's how these sorcerers work. And I wish I have time. I hope I have time. That's how these sorcerers work. That's how these magicians work. That's how these astrologers work. You give them something to work with. You tell them something about your life and they can tell you what happens. Right? That's how they function. They don't have the capacity to make something out of nothing. No, you have to give them something on which to build on. So when they did that, the king answered and said to them, I'm in verse 5. King answered and said to them, to the Chaldeans, the thing is gone from me. I highlight that for you in the text. Notice, the thing, you want me to tell you what I dreamt last night and you can get the interpretation? I have a problem, the king says, because I don't know what I dreamt. Why? The thing is gone from me. And then the king went on. If you will not make known unto me the dream with the interpretation thereof, you shall be cut in pieces and your houses shall be made into a dunghill. I just love this text. I just love this. Now we have a problem. Right? And by the way, understand, there's no human rights commission to defend these guys. Right? In the monarchy, the king rules supreme. So if the king says he's going to kill you, trust me, he's going to kill you. Ain't no constitution that can protect him. He has supreme power. So they know this is serious stuff. So for the first time in their entire career as sorcerers, their job has now put them in trouble. So they have a problem, huge problem. Pandemonium breakout in the situation room. So what's the drama? I'm moving on to verse 6. If you're just joining us, I'm in Daniel chapter 2, verse 6. What are we discussing? We're discussing the timetable for the end of the world and the second coming of Christ. And it's right here, right in this subject that we're discussing. So I'm in verse 6. So in verse 6, here the Bible continues. However, the king says, if you tell me the dream and its interpretation, you shall receive from me gifts, rewards, and great honor. Therefore, tell me the dream and its interpretation. Two things I'm requiring. I just love this stuff. Right? You tell me, you get honor. You don't tell me, you're dead. Let me say that one more. You tell me, you get honor. And these guys love honor, these sorcerers and these astrologers. Oh man, yeah, they love honor. You tell me, you get honor. You can't tell me, you're dead. Not only you, your whole family go down and your house go down. So now they have a problem. Well, let's see what's going to happen. I'm in verse 7. So they answered again, so back and forth with the king, back and forth in the situation room. They answered again and said, quote, let the king tell his servants the dream. Okay, we don't want to be disrespectful to the king, but tell us what you dreamt and we will give you the interpretation. Now the king is getting angry. Can you feel him? You're supposed to can feel the anger bubble up inside of him. Now the king is getting mad, right? So verse 8. The king answered and said, I know for certain that you would gain time. I know it's time you're trying to buy because you see that my decision is firm. I know what you're doing, the king says. Verse 9. If you do not make known to me the dream, there is only one decree for you. You have agreed to speak. Here's what the king says. The king says, I know what your guys have been doing all this time. You have agreed to speak lying and corrupt words before me till the time has changed, till now. Therefore, tell me the dream, and I shall know that you can give me its interpretation. I love the king. Tell me the dream. And if you can tell me the dream, I know you can give me, I can trust the interpretation. That's what the king is saying. I like that. If you tell me the dream, I can trust the interpretation. But you can't, you have a problem. Well, now there's a stalemate in the situation room. The air is tense. People are nervous because all of their specialities and all of their training, I like this, you know, Humpty Dumpty, all the king horses and all the king's men, right, couldn't get back that dream again. And so now there's pandemonium inside their soul as they sat before the king. So what's going to happen? I'm in verse 10. So the Chaldeans, again, they're the intelligent one. So they speak on behalf of the group one more time. And they said, the Chaldean answered the king and said, your majesty, we don't want to be respectful to the king, to your majesty, the king. But with all due respect, here's what they said. There is not a man on earth who can tell the king's matter. Not a single human being can tell. Therefore, they said, no king, no lord, no ruler has ever asked such things of any magician, astrologer, or Chaldean. So in other words, put it simple, what they're actually politely saying to the king, says, king, what you're asking is unreasonable. Hello, somebody. They have met their match, and God deliberately ran them into the king's dream so God could expose their corruption and expose their counterfeit and expose their lies and expose their errors. And people of God must understand, sorcerers and astrologers and magicians are under one bundle called deceivers. They are liars and deceivers. Nobody knows the future except God reveals it to you. Can you hear me? Nobody knows the future except God reveals it to you. And that's exactly what God did. God brought them into a situation where he can expose their lies and expose their deception. So now they tell the king, what you're asking is unreasonable, king, because no king has ever asked that of any magician. If we put all our resources together, we still can't help you. And then they continued. They said, king, it is a difficult thing that the king is requesting. Of course it is difficult. and they continued. I like this part. They said, and there is no other who can tell it to the king except the gods. Come on, G-O-D-S. Except the gods, which is the Babylonian gods that they worship, the Murdochs and you name it, what they worship. They said, only the gods can help you with this one. And by the way, there's a problem with that also. Why? Because they don't dwell with flesh. Hello, somebody. The gods in Babylon don't dwell with flesh. But oh, they haven't heard about our God. See, we have a God that dwells with flesh. The Bible says he became flesh. Word became flesh. So our God dwelt with flesh. Their gods don't. Our God is bigger. And that's exactly what God was doing. God was trying for them to understand that he is a bigger God than the gods they worship. So they reached their limit. They couldn't go any further. It was all over by the shout. For this reason, verse 12, the king was angry. Not only angry, the Bible says he was furious, right? Hopping mad. And he gave the command at once to destroy all the wise men of Babylon, right? And I highlight that for you, to destroy the royal decree issued with the stamp of the king's seal on it, right? Call up the army, go out through the entire kingdom of Babylon, and every single person who is listed on the category of wise men, scholars, prophets, anybody in that category, take them out because they are one bunch of balonies. King was mad. So watch me. So a royal execution order went out and they actually started killing all those persons who were considered to be wise people. In other words, they put a list. They have a kill list. Oh, Lord, help me here. They put together the National Security Department of National Security, rather Ministry of National Security, right? They put together a kill list of all of these guys because they have them listed. And so they went out to execute all of them. Verse 13. So the decree went out and they began, I tell you, they began killing. See, that's what the text says. They began killing the wise men. And in the process of killing, guess whose name is on the kill list? Help us. I just love this stuff. I hope you're enjoying the way I'm enjoying it. Guess whose name on the kill list? Uh-oh, when we reach down to the alphabet, to the letter D, guess whose name turn up? Daniel. They sought Daniel and his companions, the three Hebrew boys with him, to kill them. Why? Because we just read it in chapter 1, verse 20, that they were the wisest of all. So their name really should be at the top of the kill list. Oh, Jesus. You have to ask yourself the question, how is it possible that which God bless you with has now become the source of danger? Because remember, the knowledge they have was given to them by God, but now it puts them on the kill list. How do you explain that, God? And isn't it true sometimes that when God blesses us in certain way, boy, it sets us up for trouble? And that's why God doesn't give certain people certain things, because when trouble comes, we abandon him. Yeah. So they were on the kill list. But oh, if I could advise Daniel, I would have told him, if God give you wisdom and you end up on the kill list, God knew you'd have end up there even before he gives you. So he must have a way to get you off. End up on the kill list. Let me roll on. So note verse 13. So the Bible didn't say so, but my sanctified imagination kicked in. And I can imagine 4 o'clock in the morning, Daniel is sleeping. There's a knock on his door. And when he cracked the door open, guess who he saw out there? Royal soldiers from the Royal Babylonian army with swords drawn, right? And a piece of paper in their hand with the royal decree. Are you Daniel? Yes. Yeah, you live with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Yes. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, we have an execution order to kill her. Here's it in verse 14. Then with counsel and wisdom, look at this. With counsel and wisdom, Daniel answered Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, who had gone out to kill the wise men. So we know his name, the executioner. His name is Arioch, right? So Daniel had to talk to him with wisdom because he has an order to kill, right? And there's no negotiation right here, right? I have an order to kill. And I'm sure Daniel wants to negotiate with him. I have an order to kill. Daniel counsel with him and apply little wisdom. We don't know what Daniel said to him. Well, we may have a little piece of it. I'm in verse 15. He answered and said to Arioch, the king's captain. Here's what he says. Daniel said to the guy, says, question for you. Why is the decree from the king so urgent? Say, hang on, Arioch. I know you get an execution order to kill me, but before you kill me, I just want to ask a question. Why the decree so urgent? What's going on? Why the king is angry? Why does he want to kill all the wise guy? What's happening in the kingdom? Because we're in our bed. We're not aware what's going on. So tell us. Then Arioch made the decision known to Daniel. Tell Daniel what's brewing in the kingdom, why the king gave the order. King had a dream. Nobody can help him. All the wise guys failed and he got mad. He sent out an execution order and you are on the list. You are the wisest, so your name is on the top. Well, but we started at the closest one. That's why we didn't reach you first. Mm-hmm. Verse 16. So Daniel went in and asked the king to give him time. Daniel says, hey, king, here's the problem. Take me to the king. Let me talk with the king. See, Daniel knew the king because from the training, the king interviewed him. You know, so he knew the king from then. So Daniel went in and said, let me talk with the king. And he said to the king, he says, your majesty, can you give me a little time that he might tell the king the interpretation? He says, if you give me a little time, I can supply you with the interpretation. Notice this. I might tell the king the interpretation. Verse 17. Then after the king gives him a little time, we don't know what the time is. Okay. We don't know what the time that the king gave him, how much time he gave him, whether it's 1 day, 2 days, whatever, or hours. We don't know. All we know is that the king gave him a little time, which means it's a stay of execution. Praise the Lord. So Daniel went back to his house after he spoke with the king, and he made the decision known to the three friends, Ananiah, Mishael, and Mishael and Azariah, his companions, which tells us that they perhaps were living together. They're all prisoners there, or you know, down in Babylon. So it seems that they were living together or living close by, whatever. But he told them the dilemma. Hey, folks, you know, when you are in crisis like this, it's good to have righteous friends. Amen. I wish I could preach on this. It's good to have spiritual support. Oh, I wish I could preach on this. It's good to have an Abraham on top of a mountain interceding on God, to God on your behalf. Mm-hmm. I wish you could hear me. It's good to have somebody you can call up, amen, and you can lock your arms with and pray together. Why? The Bible tells us where two or three are gathered, God is there. I mean, if Daniel prayed by himself, I'm sure the Lord would have heard him. He heard him in the lion's den by himself. But, oh, when you have friends together, you can pull together and call and pray. And that's what they did. Verse 18, he called them together that they might seek the mercies from the God of heaven. This is what the Bible says concerning this secret. See the word we're looking at? That's the word we're looking at, secret. That's what we're tracking down. We're tracking down this secret, right? So that's what and that secret is the second coming of Christ, the timing of the second coming of Christ. That's what we're tracking down. So he called the friends together, three friends that he had together, and they prayed that night so that Daniel and his companion might not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Daniel prayed. He says, guys, we need to pray that God will intervene, because if God keeps silent, we're dead tomorrow. Amen. This is serious stuff, y'all. By the way, you know, when you are in situation like that, the prayer is not something you write out on paper and then recite, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy king. No. This is not the recitation prayer. Right? When your neck is on the chopping block tomorrow, this is time when you have to wrestle with God, agonize with God, plead with him. Yeah? Like Jacob did in his time of trouble, wrestle with the angel all night because he knew trouble was breaking with him in the morning. That's what you have to do, like Peter in the prison. Wrestle with God, right? Fight with God, agonize with God, wrap up with God. That's how you come out of those situations. And that's what the three boys did. And it is very clear that after they prayed, they went to bed, which is a good thing. I put up this thing on this. I put up Jeremiah 33:3 on the screen for you because Jeremiah tells us that when we are in situation like this, and Daniel must have heard this text because Jeremiah used to prophesy while he was there in Judah. Jeremiah says, call to me. God gave Jeremiah the message to the people in Babylon. Call to me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which you do not know. Write this text down. You will need it one day. Yeah, when your trouble breaks, Jeremiah says, call to me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which you do not know. Here's another text I'm going to supply for you. When you find yourself in these tragedy, Psalm 91 verse 15, the Bible says, and he shall call upon me and I will answer him and I will be with him in what? In trouble. Hey, didn't say I'll keep trouble away from him. Notice that some Christians read this thing wrong. You know, some Christians think that, oh, because I'm serving God, I won't be in any trouble. Wrong. You couldn't be more wrong. No, it says, I will be with him in trouble. Mm-mm. It's not that I will prevent him from trouble. I will be with him in trouble and I will deliver him and honor him. So yea, though we walk through the valleys of the shadows of death, he will be with us. Remember this text. When you find yourself in those circumstances for which you have no control. Powerful stuff. Here's one more for you. When there's an area knocking on your gate. Ooh, I wish I could preach here, but I promise I won't preach. I'll keep it in the study. When there's an area knocking on your gates, when the creditors are coming. Hello, somebody. Yeah, when the creditors are coming. When you find yourself, your name is on the kill list or on the chopping list, whether it be at work, whether wherever it is. Here's another text for you. Psalm 46, 1 and 2. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. That is our source of encouragement. Understand then that the days will come when there's an area at your gate, when the creditors are coming, when your name is on the kill list somewhere, when you find yourself in trouble up to your neck. God gave us these verses, and I'm sure the three Hebrew boys plus Daniel may have relied on those verses. So they went to bed, and in the morning, I'm in verse 19 of chapter 2, if you're just joining us, Daniel and the revelation. We're tracking down the secret. This is the secret. In the morning, guess what? Secret is up again. Verse 19 says, then the secret was revealed to Daniel in a night vision. Huh? So his prayer was answered. Come on, somebody need to say, praise the Lord. Okay, I will answer you. His prayer was answered while he was sleeping in the night. Which means that he prayed and went to bed. That's what you need to do. When you pray, go to bed. Don't pray and stand up fretting. Pray and go to bed. If you pray and fretting, it means you don't believe in the prayer that you just made. Pray and go to bed. That's what Daniel did. So Daniel blessed in the morning. He got up and he blessed the God of heaven. Hey, it's morning worship, yeah? Worship time in the morning. Because when he woke up in the morning, he remembered that God had given him the dream. Oh, this is so amazing stuff. While he was sleeping last night, God downloaded the dream that Nebuchadnezzar had, right, into Daniel's head. And, you know, I like to, those of you ever hear me present this before, I like to put it this way, right? When God gave the dream to Nebuchadnezzar, God pressed the delete button. So Nebuchadnezzar had the dream, but God deleted it. It wasn't saved, right? It wasn't saved. No, last night, God transferred it and downloaded it in Daniel's brain. And then God pressed the save button. So that in the morning when Daniel woke up, oh, the dream was very much alive in his brain, in his file, saved. And that's why Daniel was excited. He started having worship in the morning. The Bible says, Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. This is the morning worship. And Daniel continued. He said, and he changes times and seasons. Watch this. Because in Daniel's morning worship and morning statements, we're getting a little Blue's Clues of what the secret is about, because he's now spilling the secret here. He says he changes times and seasons, which means the dream has something about that. And he removes kings and raises up kings, which means that the dream has something about that. He's actually spilling out a little bit of the dream in his thanksgiving. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. I mean, verse 22, he reveals deep and secret things. Yes, Daniel, that's what we are tracking down here on this platform. We want to know what the secret is. So Daniel is just giving thanks to God. Yeah, he knows what is in the darkness and light dwells with him. Verse 23, Daniel says, and I thank you and I praise you, O God of my father. He's in worship, y'all, in the morning. You have given me wisdom and might, and you have now made known to me what we ask of you. For you have made known to me the king's demand. What a rejoicing. Can you hear the song that they're singing in the morning? Oh, yep. Yeah, you know, they must have strung up a lot of song in the morning. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. You know, they must have sung, when we walk with the Lord in the light of this word, with the glory he sheds on the way, trust and obey. I can hear the songs in the morning. And so they had worship. And after worship, Daniel went to Arioch, the executioner, got dressed, went to Arioch, and he says to Arioch, he says, whom the king had appointed to destroy the wise men of Babylon, he went and said thus to him, do not destroy the wise men of Babylon. Take me before the king, and I will tell the king the interpretation. Are you kidding me? Yeah, you know, yeah, take me before the king. Stop the execution. Isn't that amazing that so many people are alive today because God has some righteous people around them? The wise men in Babylon were speared because there's a man of God called Daniel. Isn't that amazing? Tremendous, tremendous. We have seen it over and over and over a time where God spear a whole city because there are some righteous people in it. Abraham was negotiating for Sodom if he could find some righteous people. Some people are alive only because you are alive. Hello, somebody. Don't kill anymore. So when he heard that, Arioch quickly brought Daniel before the king and said thus to him, I have found a man of the captives of Judah who will make known the king his interpretation. He was delighted. He ran to the king with the news. Ran to the king with the news. The king answered and said to Daniel, whose name was Belshazzar, are you able to make known to me the dream which I have seen and its interpretation? Yep, they brought Daniel before the king. The king says, do you really have the stuff? Oh man, I just love this. Do you really have the stuff? Do you really get the dream? Yeah. Are you real? Daniel says, yeah. I have the dream and I have the interpretation. Oh, Jesus. Daniel says, I have the dream and I have the interpretation. But I want to tell you something. Verse 27, Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, the secret which the king has demanded, these wise men and astrologers and magicians and suits, they cannot declare it to you. They don't have a clue. They are fake. They are fake. They are fake. They are deceivers. They can't help you with this stuff. I have the real thing. Then he says, but there is a God in heaven who reveals secret. I want to highlight that to you. There's a God in heaven. Daniel said, I'm not taking credit. No, because I didn't come up with it. But there's a God in heaven who reveals secret. And he has made known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what will be, notice this word, in the latter days. I highlight it in red for you. God has made known to you, King, what will happen in the latter days, which means the dream you have is not about your time. It's about what will happen in the last days. And if you, my friend, are listening to me right now, and if you believe we're living in the last days, then that dream belongs to us. That's the connection between us today and a dream a king had some 2,500 years ago. That's the link. Because Daniel is able to say to him, the dream that is God is about to reveal his secret, the secret of things that will happen in the last days. And then Daniel went on, your dream and the vision of your head upon your bed are these. Join me tomorrow and we will unpack what the dream is. And then we will unpack what the interpretation is. You'll be blown away as we uncover and excavate the most profound prophecy in the entire Bible as Daniel lay out the timetable that God revealed to him from his time all the way until when God puts in his appearance. And you'll be able to know with certainty how close we are to the end. Make sure you join me tomorrow. Tomorrow, we pick up right where we leave off. It's going to be at 6 p.m. Yeah, those of us on the Western West Coast, 6 p.m. in California and the Western Coast. And those of you in the East and in the Caribbean, it's going to be at 9 p.m. Whatever happens tomorrow, don't fall asleep at 9 o'clock. Those of you who are 9 p.m. region, make sure you get some friends, because tomorrow we're going to pick up right from here. Go back. We're going to find ourselves back into the king's situation room, right? And we're going to unpack that secret and explore it and give you the details of the second coming of Christ. Hope you'll join us then as we make ready for this one. All right, good. So let's see if I can have, I want to take some, I don't know if there's any question that you have. I'll be happy to look at if there's any particular question I'd be happy to take before we go. I have just a few minutes for a question. If there's any, let me know. You can just raise your hand. I'll be happy to take it. Or if there's any in the chat, that's fine too. If there's any questions, no. Well,
Pastor, we have two questions from the chat.
Okay. I see. Thank you, Mark. So I see this question that says, why is Arioch referring to Daniel as Hebrew captive? What is the significance of that? I thought he knew him as Daniel and renamed him as Belshazzar. Why is he labeling him differently? Right. So that's a very good question. Why is he referring to Daniel as a Hebrew captive? Well, in truth and in very good question. In truth and in fact, it is in fact, Daniel is in fact a Hebrew captive, meaning Daniel was among the prisoners that were captured from Judah and brought in chains down to Babylon. He was among that large group of people that were down in Babylon as prisoners. So he was in fact a Hebrew and he was in fact a captive. And you remember that psalm, I remember the psalm that says, by the rivers of Babylon where we sat down and there we wept when we remember Zion, and the wicked requires of us a song, but how shall we sing Jehovah's song in a strange land? That's down in Babylon that song was written. So all the Hebrews were down there as captives at the time, prisoners of Nebuchadnezzar, and so was Babylon, and so was Daniel. And so he became wise because of the training he had in the university, plus God gave him the knowledge that we studied in last chapter. So that's why he was on the kill list. So when Arioch found him, Arioch knew he was one of the captives, right? Arioch knew that he was from Hebrew. He didn't come from Babylon. He was a stranger. He was not even an immigrant, right? He was a prisoner in the land. So Arioch brought him to say, hey, I found among the captives. You know, in nowadays, we would have considered that to be hate speech. Yeah, we would consider that to be racial slurs. You know, but in those days, those things didn't happen. Well, it was very much racist in those times. And you will see that come out in the next couple of chapters. Right, that's why Daniel ended up in the lion's den, part of the same reason. But good question. Okay, thank you so much. Let's see. Why was Daniel not invited to the King's Dream Interpretation Task Force? Was it discrimination? Very good question. Yeah, Lois. Yeah, and so that's the point you're making. God deliberately, right? I'm reading this book by Uriah Smith. If you guys ever get a hand on it, you can read it. Daniel and Revelation. And Uriah Smith make a very fundamental point. God deliberately did not allow Daniel and the three Hebrew boys to be in that meeting at that time because God wanted to expose the conspiracy and the delusion and the deception that these astrologers were working. See, God wouldn't associate his truth with the error. God always separates truth from error. From then, even now, God separates truth from error. And so God set up the system so that they will go advance their conspiracy and fall on their faces in complete embarrassment and failure. God wants to bring them down so that the king may realize where truth come from. No longer rely on them, but now rely on Daniel. Right? Very good point. So that's the setup. God is amazing. Question, did Arioch know Daniel before? There's no indication that Arioch know him before. Possibly. Arioch worked for the king. He's the captain of the host. And so Daniel also worked in the palace. So he possibly know of him. There's a possibility, but there's no text to substantiate it. But yeah, so that's the situation as it relates to these guys there. Big, big story. Yeah, you can run the headline tomorrow morning. Yeah, big, big story and happening in Daniel. And by the way, that's how it is from this story that the prophecy of the second coming of Christ comes out. So wherever you have friends, family members, neighbors, anybody who really want to get a good understanding of where we are on the time prophecy, make sure you join us tomorrow evening at 6 p.m. on the Pacific time and 9 p.m. on Eastern time. And I'm sure you'll be blown away as we dig deep into it. All right. Until then, may God bless you and keep you. May he lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace both now and forevermore. Let's just bow our heads as we pray. Thank you, Lord, for the revelation of your word. Thank you for the depth that you have brought us to and the understanding that you have given to us. I ask now, Lord, that you will help us to digest your word and ponder your word. And Lord, as we come back tomorrow evening at 6 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m., 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern, as we come back to study, Lord, I pray again that your spirit will be with us so we can be prepared. We can be able to understand the things that are going around. We can understand why we are in a pandemic even now. We can understand what to expect. We can make our calling on our election sure. So Lord, bring us safely back tomorrow, we pray. But we ask in Jesus' name, let all God's people say, amen.
Amen.
Let
amen.
All God's have a nice day. Thank you, Pastor.
Amen.
Pastor O'Connor, Dr. O'Connor, we just want to thank you again for just allowing God to use you in such a mighty way. The word of God has truly been illuminated to us. And again, I just want to encourage all of you, no matter where you are, take out your phone, make a date with the word of God, and make sure that you're back on the platform at 6 p.m. PST or 9 p.m. Eastern time. We're going to play out with a little bit of music. And at the end of that music, the platform will be turned off. But get some fresh air. Enjoy the rest of your day. 6 p.m., 9 p.m. Eastern time. We look forward to meeting you again. Thank you all.
Tonight, tomorrow.
Sorry, tomorrow. If I said tonight, it was an error. So tomorrow.
Tonight.
P.m. EST. 9 p.m. EST. Sunday, tomorrow. Have a great day. Bye-bye.
Different department. We're going to put it in a different department.